Hi, I'm Adam, and I'm going to be talking to you guys today about the thesis project that I just finished in May called Lost in Performance, Performative Processes to Save the Lost Bytes. So we all save a lot of digital information. We all have tons of photographs, videos that we store and save online, chat conversations that we're having on a daily basis, hundreds and hundreds of emails. And all of these digital files are really representations of our own digital memories. So this brought up a lot of questions for me. What does saving our digital artifacts afford us? In a society where the majority of information is becoming digital, it's important to ask about the security of this information that we save online. The ability to save and store content is becoming easier and cheaper, and this is resulting in a massive amount of data. But we never really consider what we gain or lose as a result of saving all this information. Do repetitive processes provide opportunities for reflection and evaluation? We're constantly undergoing numerous daily tasks that require us to perform procedures over and over again, and we rarely consider the actions that are taking place. I mean, if we think about how many times that we copy and paste text, or how many times we click send on an email, or we take a picture on our phones, the speed at which we're digitally performing is so fast that we don't have time to consider the consequences of these actions. And I'm really interested in these repetitive processes as moments for reflection, where we could take the time to acknowledge what it is that we are actually doing and how it affects us. Can our memories be accurately replicated and produced? It's important to realize the limitations of human performance. When it's so easy for us to duplicate things digitally, we almost think that the same thing can be done physically. But it's really impossible to produce these same results with human actions and human data because of all the variables that affect both of our mind and our body. And so, what is lost in the process of processing all of our information is really the core question of what I was really interested in looking at. So, performance. My background is in dance, and that's really the core of what I was really interested in looking at when I started looking at data and information, was looking at it from a perspective of performance. So performance is the execution of an action. It's something that it's accomplished, and it's the manner in which a mechanism performs. So for me, performing really became synonymous with processing. When information is processed, it's either digitally or physically performing. Whoops. Just go back one second. So the human brain is performing a series of neurological tasks in order to process our memories. And similarly, machines are constantly performing digital tasks in order to process bytes of memory. And this idea of performing and processing in repetition is really important in my work, because it symbolizes the notion that, like machines, we're constantly trying to do things over and over again. So Lost in Performance is a series of critical artworks that explores the relationship between memory, data, performing, and processing. The main focus of the collection of these artworks is to draw attention to the temporal aspects of our memories, questioning the process in which we save and store information. Performing and process become interchangeable actions as each piece is continuously repeated using a variety of digital and analog methods. Personal photographs and home videos are used as the core content in this work, suggesting the relationship between performance, process, and memory. The visual aesthetics of the work expose the deteriorating effects of time and repetition, suggesting that memory, both human and digital, are imperfect and do not last forever. Loss in Performance affords the opportunity to reflect on the past, generating a dialogue around the methods and intention for remembering.
we were actually talking about this a little bit last night. Within about a month, I found out about the death of two friends, not from a phone call, not from a face-to-face interaction, but of course on their Facebook page. The first person I had lost contact with in high school, he had recently friended me, and I thought for sure I must have had the wrong profile, because the person that I knew had run triathlons and swam and was an active athlete. And the Facebook page I found said that this person was suffering from a level 4 type of brain cancer. And shortly after finding me, within 6 weeks, he had passed away. And I had followed his wife, who was blogging about the situation, because my friend was no longer able to communicate because of the brain tumor pressing on his cerebrum and whatnot. The second person also was someone I worked with in my undergraduate days, who was a really great person. I had known for years, worked at the college radio station, and again, a young man in his early 30s, lost to brain cancer, another sort of brain cancer. And so it was very hard for me to kind of come to terms with this. And I thought, well, I'm a literature person, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to try and write about this, and I want to try and figure this out. What does this mean that I found out about these deaths, again, via the internet, via Facebook? And so another part of my project then, sort of the other part of this, was inspired, of course, by Jacques Derrida, The Gift of Death. And this is something at Wayne State, you know, I'm sure most of us have our critical theory classes that you probably have gone through. And Derrida, of course, is one of the people that we rely on. And so I'd just like to start with this quote from Jacques Derrida from The Gift of Death. Even if one gives me death to the extent that it means killing me, that death will still have been mine, and as long as it is irreducibly mine, I will not receive it from anyone else. Thus, dying can never be taken, borrowed, transferred, delivered, promised, or transmitted. And just as it can't be given to me, so it can't be taken away from me. And so again, this was sort of important to me as I considered this project. And we know about the multiplicity of ways that the internet has been changing our lives, countless, you know, online banking, online dieting, but what I'm interested in again today is how the internet is changing death. One thing that I've noticed is that since approximately World War II, death and the way we handle death in our culture has changed. When my grandparents were younger, people would actually have wakes where the body of the person would be in someone's home, and people would be able to sort of visit with that person, and the body of the corpse would be in the home with those people. I think today, however, we've sort of distanced ourselves from death, the corporeal presence of death. I think one way that this happens is that we use nursing homes, and I've seen in my own life, and I probably you have as well, where the elderly have been kind of pushed aside. We don't really necessarily keep our elderly. I know in earlier times, right, the whole family was sort of this nuclear extended family where grandmother and grandfather would sort of live out their final days in the comfort of the home around their grandchildren, their children, and it was a completely sort of different way of doing things. But today, however, they're sort of pushed aside in the nursing homes, and I feel like this is an attempt to sort of separate ourselves from the physical sort of having to look at death. Here again, this is a nursing home, but we have this, these sort of spaces that are designated for the people who are dying. So then what do I make of what's going on in the internet? You know, we have this, but now what's happening today? Let's see. I wanted to figure out whether then, okay, I'm incorporating or meeting people from my life who are now dead on the internet. And what does that mean? Does that mean that we're trying to re-encounter the dead? Are we trying to somehow keep them alive? And so what I use in this paper then is image theory. I thought it was a really good fit for this particular conference. And I basically started with Lambert Wiesing, who in his text, Artificial Presence, Philosophical Studies and Image Theory, to sort of assist me in first defining what happens on the internet as image per se. Because I'm not always sure how to define what's going on in the web, and so I wanted to sort of talk about them as images. And so some of what Wiesing writes is very important to my own paper. And so an early point made by Wiesing's philosophical readings is, quote, the idea of an artificial presence produced by image is like a thread running through phenomenological image theory and can be regarded as its main idea, hence the title of this book. This is also an appropriate stopping place for my own suppositions. Artificial presence then is not only central to imaging, but central to the idea of being online. Being active in the cyber world allows one to simultaneously step in two worlds or more, depending on how many windows are open on their desktop. When we are online, we're hence an artificial presence. Whether chatting, instant messaging, Skyping, shopping, or posting, our presence is artificial. A marker of who we are in an immaterial space, maybe not so different from what we see in the Matrix films. Besides being literally able to fashion animated avatars to put on profiles, our online self is virtually an avatar, existing possibly in a non-physical universe of packets and protocols, binary codes, domain names, and servers. Being online, then, is sort of the ultimate simulacra. Even notice how commonplace the term avatar has come. I mean, 15 years ago, no one was talking about avatars like they are today.
As I began to explore this intersection of empathy and technology, I decided to ground it in a specific human condition, one that we've all dealt with to some degree, and that is death. I personally have an acute inability to accept the idea that when a loved one dies, this intricate being that's taken years to develop, both physically and mentally, can be completely gone in a matter of a second. But as I grapple with this, I have a hard time imagining where they might be and in what place and in what form. I find myself saying things like they're in a better place without having a solid idea of where that is or what it's like. So how has science and technology affected the way that we handle death and subsequently the afterlife? It became obvious to me that our distant ancestors had amazingly vivid explanations for death and the afterlife. For example, the Aztecs believed that we battle 8 treacherous journeys only to meet the final challenge that requires the aid of a dog who is sacrificed at the time of the person's death. And if we succeed at that challenge, we then enter the eternal house of the dead, which is ruled by the god and goddess of death depicted here. So, and even today, in rural parts of northern Mexico and China, people believe that the deceased soul lingers over the body for 3 days. And while the soul does not want to see its loved ones too sad, it doesn't want to see them happy either. For this reason, families will hire professional criers to be present at funerals. Paid criers, while it is a concept widely known in the Western world, is often viewed as absurd and inappropriate. So, in an age when science and technology have prevailed, I've looked to scientifically and technologically informed design to assist us in the processes of personal grieving. How can these technologies be reappropriated to help us better remember and even celebrate our dead? I found a quote written by Joan Didion after she lost her husband of 40 years that feels extremely relevant to this project. Nor can we know ahead of the fact, and here lies the heart of the difference between grief as we imagine it and grief as it is. The unending absence that follows, the void, the very opposite of meaning, the relentless succession of moments during which we will confront the experience of meaninglessness itself. In absentia seeks to find meaning in the absence of a loved one. While it's true their mind and body are no longer with us, this system helps looks to create an imaginative stance towards their remains. The project has 2 sets of fictional services, dust tracking and energy succession. The dust tracking project views dust as a tiny yet powerful marker of presence rather than absence, representing the impossibility of disappearance. It uses tiny sensors, often referred to as smart dust, and weather patterns to track the dispersed ashes of a loved one. Since traditional ashes are too large to make much distance, this process further pulverizes them to become roughly the size of a period at the end of the sentence. A sensor equal in size is then adhered to each particle, and the particles are then numbers. They can be divided up amongst friends and family if desired. The system comes with a set of final instructions that the user will fill out before their passing, instructing their loved ones on what they want done with their ashes. The dust is then dispersed in a manner where it will reach the free atmosphere, which begins at 6,000 feet. Here you see a man dispersing his late wife via a weather balloon. Weather balloons will usually reach up to 130,000 feet and then burst. This is sort of one of the better ways to disperse your loved one. The system allows loved ones to follow and even script the journey of their deceased. Using weather patterns, friends and family can send their deceased to meaningful places and track them using this online interface. It gives you the coordinates, the miles per hour, elevation, and number of particles. This person has been traveling for over 600 days and has divided into 6 main groupings of dust. This will also tell you the best location if you're looking to retrieve the dust, which I'll get into in just a second. It also allows the ability to embed sound, image, text, and video files in the sensors. So if you find one while you're tracking them online, you can hear their voice, view their photos, and relive the memories of them. The system also comes with a set of services called the Interpretum, which is essentially a group of experts whose job it is to find meaning in the paths they take, the shapes they've made, and the encounters that they've had in their journeys. So it's similar to a spiritual medium, but using this dust pattern.
We're thinking about it again, which I really appreciate that comment. So I don't know what you guys think.
I mean, one thing that comes to mind is, I think as a community and a culture, we're tending to mourn together just due to the accessibility of information, and everybody is processing things together, whether it's 9/11 or people using social media and Twitter, they're becoming these like hubs to share information and deal with experiences together, rather than these individual sessions of mourning when someone would die, you know, maybe you'd get their photographs and you'd get these sort of physical remembrances of them, but now sort of like these memorial pages, you're able to see how people are grieving together, and it's much more accessible. So maybe the people that are mourning don't feel so isolated and alone in their sort of process.
Yeah, I think it's interesting to see the reactions of that. You know, I think some people, they just want to keep a Facebook page up forever and leave it up, and some people are so uncomfortable with it. It's an interesting time where it's like a weird dichotomy of it. You know, people don't want it on the screen, and then some people do want it on the screen, and it's just the pervasiveness of this information is, I mean, it's good and bad, you know, depending on the side of the bench you're on. But yeah, I mean, I think to your point, like, why are so many people dying of cancer? Like, that's really what inspired me on this. People are dying younger and younger, and we have the ability to record data like never before, so why am I stuck with a two-dimensional photo when, you know, technology hasn't really been addressed as sort of a memory maker?
There he does. Concern, I mean, he's not just defining a state of affairs. I think that statement is he's trying to hold on to, and it's the way you conclude your paper, Erin, as well, is trying to hold on to the possibility that death won't be taken away from us. My own conviction is that we are holding on to that more and more because I don't think we're allowed to be as alive as we might hope to be. I think that this contemporary dealing with death, it is not a result just of technology. Technology has, and our new relationship to death has exposed it. But I think the underlying problem is that we are less and less being allowed to fully lead human lives, if we ever were. And so one of the last things we're trying to hold on to is our own demise, the way we're remembered, the way we're memorialized, the way our dust is collected and dispersed. And I mean, I thought that was so beautiful in your presentations and your project, that the idea of, okay, at least after I'm dead, I will have a material presence. I'm not going to be allowed to have a material presence that matters while I'm alive. But for me, there's a bit of solace in that, in the knowledge that, okay, here's what I want you to do with me when I'm gone. Disperse me and track the movements of my dust modes. And that will accord me a kind of life that I'm not now allowed to have.
Right, and then thinking back to Erin's paper when she was talking about that process of grieving being very much focused in the family. And then when I was reading those Facebook comments, I was thinking about the community that, like the reversal of that, so the community that's created around the death that has taken place, and then the engagement that happens with the person that's gone. And it's like, like you said that this mourning process is not so individual anymore, but then who is allowed to be part of the community of the dead person? Like, if we were thinking about, I guess, going to a cemetery, like, you can't just, you know, like, I mean, I guess you could just go into a cemetery and, like, talk to random people, but there's not that not that kind of like interactivity that I guess the web allows, like these certain actions, I guess. It's not as, I know that you were talking about images, but it's a little bit different, I think, because the way you, I guess, engage with Facebook allows for something else. Because I think before Facebook, I don't know, like maybe what happened with email addresses, but I don't think that people would have sent emails to the dead as
right.
much. And there's something about that public display and being able to collectively read those comments together that somehow, but then I wonder about that level of engagement, if that, like Tom said, is like real human or,
I've seen a lot with celebrities, you know, after a celebrity dies, where then it brings suddenly there's like 80,000 people sort of conversing. You know, exactly. And I was like, wow, you know, all of a sudden there's like a site dedicated to memorializing this person. And I think that's a good point, like bringing together people that never would have met, that are, you know, sort of spanning generation and, you know, geography, and they're all coming together in the name of Steve Jobs or whatever celebrity. So it's kind of interesting. But again, I like your question, is that really, you know, is that surface, is that transparent, or is that really real community?
And I had a question about the web and like the limit of the space. I know that there's a lot of like new laws about like privacy and how, you know, there will be this like authorized person enabled to get rid of certain domains, and I don't really know that much about the internet and how much, like, is it, you know, can we keep adding more websites, and is there a limit? Because I know that in certain, you know, areas of the world, the practices where you bury someone is very spatially consuming, so then a lot of countries have these like danger warnings, like we don't have enough space for living people because there's so much cemetery space, and how to deal with that. And I was wondering if maybe that kind of question is applicable to the web or to blogging or to your project with saving images, like how, what's the limit? Is there, like a police tracking?
I'm interested in your idea of Bernard, and maybe this was a little bit different topic, but I want to ask about the like digital footprint. Right now, since Facebook is so pervasive and everybody's using, and even though like this person, even though they died, they still exist in the Facebook or wherever it is, they live like forever unless they delete their account, and everybody is still. Some people, even if they are not close together, they still live, or they're still like doing something. But so my point is, how do you like, think about the digital point, even though you will live and we make ourselves like reflect in the digital world, and even though we die, it's still there, and people are still seeing, some people still be alive, and how do you like, think about that?
You know, one of the things that we just assume that there's an opposition between real material presence, human presence, and digital absence of that material presence. But I think if we looked into that distinction, I don't think it would hold much water. So one wants to assume, oh yeah, I have presence here, but then you ask yourself, well, what kind of presence is it? Is someone seeing me? Is someone hearing my voice? Is someone taking in my words? And so presence is not an obvious thing at all. You know, this is why the absence or the loss of something is also something that a culture has to formulate and deal with. I mean, Freud has a very straightforward, pretty well acknowledged idea in his famous essay on mourning and melancholia about loss. You know, loss is, you know, I could say right now, in terms of absence, like who's absent right now? Well, all of the people who were in third grade with me at St. Mary's Catholic School in Detroit, Michigan, they're all absent from this room. And on one hand, that's true. None of them are here. they're not here. Absence or loss means an expectation that something or someone should be here. So when we talk about our presence here now, we assume that being here bodily